overview of the conditions of the world. I will give you an overview of the political landscape in Denmark, and then look at the climate action plan. And sorry, I'm catching a cold earlier this week. But I try to give you this introduction. As you know, we had a general election in Denmark the 5th of June. And it was quite interesting because it was the first climate election in Denmark. Maybe one of the first climate elections in the world, actually. For the last couple of decades, the elections in Denmark has been elections about foreigners' integration. But suddenly, actually for most of us, it came as a surprise, I think. It became a climate election, meaning that the most important thing for the 13 parties involved, or most of them, was their initiatives in the climate issue. And there was a debate in national broadcasting TV2 one day. I watched it, and the question was, who of you are the most ambitious party when it comes to climate? So I think 11 of the 13 raised their hand. Well, if you look at Danish climate policy, it's very interesting to look just 4 years back, the last election in 2015, when the Liberals came into power, saying that we want green realism. Meaning that we have to look at the costs for the businesses. We have to look at the PSO, public service obligation. And we do not want to be the most ambitious in the world at all. And then in 2018, there was a shift made by the Conservatives and the Prime Minister, I think, going for green options. Meaning that now we had to look at the climate issue. That was after the Paris Agreement, of course. And we had to look at the transportation sector. And they started up having a transportation commission. And my new government, and Dan Jørgensen, the new Minister for Climate, Energy and Utilities, he says, and our Prime Minister says, that we need to be a world-leading climate nation. Look at that. 4 years going from being green, realistic, to world-leading. I think you will see that transition in a lot of other European countries for the coming years. But it's very interesting, and very interesting to be part of it. Trying to set out the course for a lot of people for 4 years, saying in the beginning we need to be green realistic and how we want to be world leading. I think most of my employees find it more ambitious and more motivating to be world leading. This is the Danish Parliament. This is the seat in the Danish Parliament as we know today. And you can look at the green and red dots, and that's the new majority, the climate majority. And actually, the Social Democrats didn't have to use the alternatives, maybe the most progressive Green Party, looking at non-growth, etc. And they didn't have to let them in the negotiations when they settled down after the election, trying to find out if they could be the governing party. So if you look at the Social Democrats, the Radikale Venstre, the Socialist People Party, and Enhedslisten, they are 91 seats, and you only need 90 seats in the parliament to have a majority. So you still have the alternatives if one or two of the other seats want to be liberal or conservative in the future. So that's a quite strong majority in the Danish perspective. And what do the government want to do, and what do the supporting parties want to do? That is written down in the understanding paper from the 25th of June this year. And it says a lot of things, but if you look at the first chapter, it actually is the first chapter, saying that this is the most important goal, I think. It says a lot of things, but I have listed the most important up here. First of all, the 70% reduction of greenhouse gas emissions, as Paul said. Restructuring the transport sector. They want a ban for sale for new diesel and gasoline cars in 2030. Secure the agricultural sector, so the agricultural sector also would have to deliver greenhouse gas reduction in 2030. Adopt an action plan for climate change. I'll come back to that in a minute. And take responsibility for more ambitious European Union politics. And this is my minister, Dan Jørgensen. The former was Minister for Energy, Utilities and Climate. Dan Jørgensen is Minister for Climate, Energy and Utilities. The name says a lot. And if you look at the initiatives in the government, they want to improve the coordination between the ministries, meaning that they have set up a new committee, the Green Committee. And the last time they came up with a new committee, that's decades ago. So now we have a Green Committee coordinating green initiatives, climate, environment, transportation, etc. We also have a green Minister of Finance. He says he's green, and I think he is. And he will develop green calculation methods in the coming years. So a lot of the first initiative from the government underlines that it actually is a green government. But let's look at the action plan. What's in it? It's also written in the understanding paper, and that's some of the topics that will be in it. I think we have to look at much more areas to get even close to 70%. But very quickly, energy efficiency in public buildings, the national strategy for construction, national strategy for electrification of transport, industry and society, that's a big truck. More resources allocated for research and demonstration projects. They want to reach 1 billion Danish kroner in the coming years. A strategy for offshore wind in the North Sea countries. We already have a very good cooperation, but we want it to be even closer. And then this Energir, an energy island, an energy hub in the middle of the North Sea, where you can connect up to 10 gigawatts of offshore wind. And if we remember the learning curve that Paul told us about before, you can see if just a few countries build these kinds of offshore wind energy hubs in the North Sea, the price will come down rapidly in the decades to come. And then once again, EU as a climate union, meaning that we are a very small country, actually 5.8 million Danes. And if we do a lot of things, nothing will happen to the climate. But hopefully we can inspire other nations to do the same. that's actually one of the things that I'm very proud of, that the Danish Energy Agency does. We have 15 partnerships with other countries around the world. So all these things can hopefully inspire other nations to go on the same road as we do. Well, let's have a very close, well, not very close, very a short look at the and the climate action plan that the government wants to come up with in the spring. And here you see almost the same figure as all shows before, saying if we have a frozen policy scenario as we do in Danish Energy Agency, we can expect that we will have reductions of 46% in 2030. That's about 38 million tons. But we need 70% reduction. We need to go down to 21%. So we are approximately half the way. And every time I'm talking about this journey going from 1919 until 2030, I think it's very important to realize that we are only half the way, and this has been the most easiest part. It doesn't bother us if the electricity that gave us the line in this room and show my slide to you comes from coal-fired power plants or from offshore. We don't matter. It doesn't matter. But if we want to go to 70% reduction, maybe we need to eat something else. We need to transport ourselves in a new way. But so much by airplane. And actually, the next part of the journey is also a part where we need a mindset, a new mindset that is not the same as the one that brought us to today. So it's going to be a very interesting journey, I think. But let's look at some of the most easiest parts of the action plan, because as Paul said, actually it has been the energy sector that has delivered most of the reductions until now. And it's still the energy sector that can deliver a lot of the reductions that we need, because we have some technologies that can help us. If we look at the households, the potential is very low. It's less than 1 million tons production, but the technology is there. Less oil heating, and we need heating pumps. We have the technology. It's going to be cheaper and cheaper. So that's a no-brainer. If we look at the electricity sector, we expect that in 2028 we'll have more than 100% of our consumption that will come from or our production that will come from renewables. So 2 years before 2030, we will reach 100%. And if we look at the heating sector, we will have phased out most of the coal. I think we'll have phased out all the coal in 2030, and we will still have some fossil or some emissions from the waste incineration, where we have some fossil parts. That's a tricky point, but we are almost there. Then if we look at the industry, there are some potentials. We're talking about 7 million tons, 2030. And of course, there's base heating, can be electrified. The medium temperature process heating can be electrified. Internal transport, hopefully, if it's not too heavy, can be electrified. And then we have the high temperature process heating. That's a tricky question. And especially because we can see there are some emissions, the grade of the lines, not coming from energy, but coming from emissions, especially from cement production, the chemical process when you produce cement. So, well, we need concrete in Denmark after 2030, so we need to solve that problem. We all do. And then, of course, we have the transportation sector. We have a lot more electrified cars. But still, I think one of the biggest problems actually in Denmark is that a lot of our taxes comes from cars. More than 50 billion Danish kroner. So it's not only a technology issue, it's also how to finance the welfare society in the future. And it doesn't have to be electrified all of it. We're looking at power to X at the moment. It's very interesting. And in the end, the agriculture sector, and that's very important to do something about, but it's very difficult at the same time because it's on the market, it's on the global markets. So if we come up with a lot of bans, restrictions, it will only mean that the production will go to Poland, Germany, Baltic region, and the earth that we want to protect won't be any better. So we need to find out how to reduce emissions from the animals and from the land. Yes, we need some new keys to play on. And that's what makes this so interesting. My minister says that this action plan, we can't do the 70% in one action plan. So I think he will come up and split it in two or three parts, saying that, well, we go for the first third of the reduction that we needed for the next 3 or 4 years, and then the next third in the middle of the trenches, and the last third in the end of the trenches. And I think that's a clever decision, because in most of the sectors, the technology helps us around. Thank you very much.